Welcome back to Panthera, everyone. It is finally time to see if the MkII Supra race car is going to make some angry super noise, or at least some baby step angry super noise. It is time to crank this thing. First, though, I'd like to share a little bit of information with you guys. For anyone who's trying to use a Holley Dominator or Holley's EFI ecosystem on a less than well-supported platform, like if you have an LS, not going to be hard to get that sucker running. With this guy, you're pretty much starting from a blank sheet of paper. Now, one of the first issues I had trying to get this guy to fire is cam sync, all down to one of these little guys. Now, when I first bought everything to put this car together, well, it was 2 a.m. and I was really tired. And so my first piece of advice is gonna be, make sure you know what kind of sensors you have. Because in this application, the first time I tried to crank it, I had the correct crank sensor. It's a magnetic Hall effect sensor. But this one that I bought for cam sync ended up being a flying magnet sensor. Now, because it's a three-wire Hall effect sensor, I was like, oh, it's gotta be a ferrous target sensor, right? It is not, only works with a magnet. So you need the one, which looks exactly the same in every way, same thread and everything, different plug, different pinout. But if you're using a setup similar to this where you're trying to count teeth, you need to use the ferrous sensor. So that was oops number one. But let me show you how I figured that out. So one of the cool features of the Holley EFI system is something called a system log. If you go into data log, set up ECU logging, typically it's set to a normal data log. If you set this to system log right here, it will give you essentially a trace view of a few of the critical sensors you'll need to get this guy chooching. So for example, if I go open up one of my previous system logs here, and I have RPM crank and cam selected, you can see, if I zoom in a bunch, these green traces are my crank position sensor. Hopefully that's not being GoPro'd to death, but these are all fine. It's counting teeth. I'm getting my TDC missing tooth just fine. But this blue trace here is my cam sync, and you can see it is not doing a dang thing. And this little step here is RPM trying to figure out what's going on, not working out. So that told me I either had a wiring issue or the sensor was bad, or as it turned out to be, there's actually the wrong sensor in the car. Without that trace, I just have no idea what's going on. So that's a really cool little feature if you're using non-standard sensors, or even if, as with my case, I'm using Holley sensors, I just had the wrong one. That is a really quick and easy way to figure that out. So now if we go to a more recent system log, I am counting teeth on my crank position sensor, and I'm counting the cam sync tooth, and you'll see it's about 10 or 12 teeth before the missing tooth on TDC, which is right where you want it. So with this setup, I have sync, I have RPM, and we are pretty much ready to fire. And really, if you have a decent base fuel map and reasonable base timing, really the only thing you need to figure out after that is your cranking fuel, which there are examples out there based on the displacement of your engine. I'm gonna start with 8 pounds an hour on this relatively small 5 MGE, no turbo, unfortunately, and we'll see if she shoots. So, turn everything on. Link. Startup enrichment. We're at 8. I want my AFR and ignition timing. Let's see what she does. Okay. She goes kaboom. I'm guessing that's either nowhere near enough fuel. Yeah, that's nowhere near enough fuel. Okay, let's crank that up to, let's try 12. See what that has to say. She going boom boom. So we are backfiring like a mother, so either something is wrong with my timing, and actually, here's another little trick I'll throw in here. If you're kind of a one-man band and you're trying to make sure your ignition timing is on while you're cranking, that's really hard to do because obviously you need to crank the car, and if you don't have an engine bay starter button, you're kind of hooped. Here's a little trick that I use. You Yep, zip tie your timing light to a coolant hose and stick a GoPro in there. Actually works very well. So I know the timing is pretty close. It's a few degrees off, but I'll deal with that later in my ignition config. Right now, I just need to find out why it is going boom, boom, and I am assuming it is nowhere near enough fuel. Okay, so I found another interesting pitfall to learning Holley's EFI ecosystem, and that is when you're doing what I'm doing, which is starting from a completely base empty mat with nothing defined on a custom application, there's some learning curves involved. One little thing I'd like to share with you is this little guy over here. I don't know if it will come through, but let's see. Fuel modifiers. These are really important. The stock base global folder or map, when you start building it, all this coolant temperature enrichment and air temperature enrichment, this is all at zero. When all of that is zero, as soon as your engine transitions from cranking fuel to the fuel table, your injectors turn off, which is unideal. Set it to 100 and it's a little bit better. Let's give it a try. And I gotta tune that fuel table, but she's choochin'. Hell to the yeah. Not my dash kind of wigged out, but working. Heck yeah. Now let's do some base tuning on this thing and hopefully get in the dyno pretty soon.
A few moments later.
You may be wondering, seeing as how I just got my Mark II Supra running on the Holley Dominator, why said Holley Dominator is over here on the naughty bench? Well, because Murphy's Law took a hand and I broke the frickin' USB connector off of my $2,500 ECU. Awesome. Yeah, so if you have really any of Holley's ECUs, you're probably familiar with this little guy. It is a mini USB connector that you pretty much program the entire USB with, has a little locking collar on it, and it is crap. In fact, if there is one thing I have to say against Holley so far with my experience with them, it is this garbage. Now, all is not lost if you're in the same boat I am. You can actually, if you have a fairly recent firmware, talk to the Dominator over CAN bus. You will need Holley's CAN bus dongle. It's $70 or so. It's just a little cable, as Holley's CAN implementation is proprietary. But that does work, and honestly, that's kind of how I personally recommend you talk to the ECU and just leave this garbage disconnected unless you absolutely need it, because odds are good you will break one off. After all, that's why there's companies out there like Motion Raceworks making little cable saver brackets for this thing, but honestly, that's a band-aid for a short-sighted design, shall we say, on Holley's part that could very likely bite you. So if you're running these ECUs, be careful. Option B is to fix the connector. And unfortunately, fortunately in some ways, the entire ECU is potted with epoxy. So to replace this connector off the board, not gonna happen. Now, if you break it in such a way the pins are still accessible, you can actually fix it so long as you are reasonably experienced with microsoldering and you have some decent equipment, like, for example, one of these Hakko irons and a magnifier and some helping hands and essentially some experience soldering very, very small things. If you don't, I honestly would not attempt this. I fixed this just because I could, and it's gonna have a USB-A dongle on it, kind of probably what Holley should have done to begin with. But going forward, I'm just going to talk to this guy over CAN bus, as that is a way more robust and harder to break thing. So let's go stick this back in the car and see if it works, and then pot it up and forget that I lost 3 hours of my life fixing this thing. Encouraging. Okay. Send what I have to the ECU. Synced. Is it really though? Yeah. Restart. Open. Okay. As you can see, we can talk to the ECU again. So that was a very annoying fix, but it can be done if you know a little bit about soldering and have the right tools. Okay, and with that done, we have pretty much the same repair that Holley will do if your ECU is fixable and you send it to them. Put a dongle on it, epoxy the pins, good to go. But if your pins are broken off with the epoxy, too bad, use CAN bus. Anywho, let's put this thing back in the car and get back to work. Well, in addition to all that fun ECU stuff, we've made some other progress in the car. Got our big Horkin splitter done. It's just in primer right now. This is gonna be getting painted pretty soon. We've also got our bulkhead to cover the fuel cell all done and coated, and that's ready to go on. And we've also got our spiffy diffuser all powder coated and ready to go back on the car. So with all that done and all of our sensors finally set up properly, had a little issue with my fuel level sender. Pro tip there, make sure you get your pin numbers right when you're sticking stuff in there and get it on a thermistor and not a ground. That'll get you. But everything is good now and it is time to put the car on the ground and head to the dyno and make some angry noise. So probably this will about do it. I might do a little short video of dyno-toing the car and then we're gonna go and test it at a local racetrack pretty soon. But that is pretty much it for the MkII Supra. We'll have more videos on this guy in a bit because next up, we are getting back into that thing, which is getting a different ECU and also going back in the dyno. And then I will have many cars that actually run and drive, which will be awesome. All right, guys, thanks for tuning in. Appreciate it as always, and I will see you in the next video.